I've been making video games since 2019, but I'm never creating an online multiplayer game until now, except a fake. Is this video fake too? No, it's real. So here's a question. Why would anyone possibly want to fake a multiplayer game? Cause it's hard, bro. It's frustrating and prone to bugs. I've actually tried making a real multiplayer game, and it wasn't exactly a smooth experience. Also, who's gonna play a multiplayer game without players on an empty server? Let's be honest, new and unpopular indie games do not have any players, and by faking them, you can have as many as you wish. Bots and not players, but still. Another reason is internet lag and delay. It is very annoying when you click and a character moves seconds later. No one likes that, so just fake it. Trust me, it'll be much faster. Now let's start making fake.io, but first we need a game engine, a grid background, a unique mechanic, fake players, and a join server button. Okay, we also need a gameplay loop. The first steps are always the easiest. Open Godot, create a new project, create a map, create some blobs, food. Well, it only took like half an hour. I should be done by tomorrow.
15 days later.
It took a bit longer than I first thought, but I think it's done by now. Let me just fix this real quick.
25 days later.
I can now proudly say that the game is finally done.
32 days later.
I achieved it, guys. No errors, no warnings, just pure gameplay experience. I've implemented some fake stuff like this loading screen and a ping indicator in order to make the multiplayer feature more believable and fake, I guess. These blobs are just bots behaving like real players. We have four types of bots. AFK bots just move in a random direction. Noob bots will avoid borders and big blobs. Pro bots will do that and also follow small blobs. Expert bots are a little smarter. They can predict blob positions in the near future. This actually was a fun part to develop, because I love math, and in order to code a function that predicts blobs positions after an unknown amount of time and calculates a direction to the possible meeting point of the blobs, you need to solve a quadratic equation. Will you still say that you don't need math in programming? Apart from math, you also need to think about game's performance. Do you see these little dots on the map spawning randomly? They're food, and bots cannot see them. Do you know why? Because of performance issues, of course. When I first implemented bots, they could see food and follow them, but it was painfully slow, and after 3 days of profiling, debugging, and trying out different solutions, I just decided to remove the feature. Yeah, game devs might eventually end up removing features they've been developing for a long time. The problem is how area2d nodes work in Godot. See, food nodes are area2d nodes on layer 3. I use another area2d node to check if any food is nearby. It seems that area2d nodes scan the whole range of collisions on layer 3, which are 10,000 food nodes. This is done every physics frame for each area2d, in this case 50 times for each bot. In total, it adds up to 500,000 checks. The performance gets even worse when the actual frame rate is less than the physics frame rate. By default, physics simulation is set to 60 fps, and the physics process function may run up to 8 times per frame. This means that on 30 fps, physics process runs twice per frame, on 15 fps, 4 times per frame, and on 7.5 fps, 8 times per frame. Yeah, I have experienced what it feels like to play a game on 7 fps. In total, up to 4 million checks per frame. This is insane. In contrast, when bots are scanning for nearby blobs, the check count never gets above 2500 checks per frame, maybe 5000 checks on slow systems with 30 fps experience. So what's the solution? Just remove painfully slow features. Done. One problem solved, another one to go. This is relatively simple one though. Instantiating and deleting objects are expensive, and we can solve this problem with object pooling. The idea is that you can instantiate 10,000 food nodes once and then reuse them. So instead of instantiating 10 new objects, find and show 10 hidden objects. Instead of deleting an object, hide it. Are you still here? I am talking to you. Why don't you like and subscribe? Thanks. To the next topic. I want my games to be equally accessible across different displays. But when I first tested the game, it looked like this. Two issues that occurred are smaller UI on higher DPI monitors and these grey boxes on non-standard aspect ratios. It turns out you can change this behavior from window settings. Stretch mode set to canvas items fixes the UI scaling issue. All canvas items are the same size across different displays. Stretch aspect set to expand gets rid of those ugly grey boxes. This is not a universal solution though. You see, we are trying to solve a problem causing another. Players with narrower displays will reveal less map at the sides. That's another compromise to be made. Now you know how to fake a multiplayer feature, but there are many more things that great video games have in common, like an appealing UI design. If you want to know how to make a nice looking menu in Godot, click this video. And thanks for watching. By the way, you can play fake.io on each. The link is in the description.